Julia Phillips, first of all, thanks so much for joining us and being part of the book club.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm thrilled.
Tell me a little bit. I mean, this is such an unusual moment, and here we are doing this via Skype. Where are you? How is your life affected?
I'm in New York in my apartment. I guess I'm in the sixth week now of being in my apartment. And life has definitely changed quite a bit, but I feel lucky to be personally safe and healthy as much as possible.
So let's go to the book, Disappearing Earth. A lot of questions came in about the place, the setting, the why you wrote this. Let's just go right to Martha Samsel from Morgantown, West Virginia. Why did you write the book, and how long did it take to research and write it?
It took about 10 years from the conception of the project to publication. So I always wanted to be a novelist growing up. Really dreamed of writing stories. And I also had this abiding interest in studying Russian language. I was born right at the end of the Cold War and was fascinated by how the America I knew and grew up in had so much to do with Russia and the Soviet Union, and was really, a lot of the American culture I knew was formed out of that relationship, that international relationship. So I studied Russian language, and eventually I thought, well, maybe I can combine both these interests. And if I set a book in Russia, then I can move to the country and keep studying the language and keep learning and also work on my craft. So I hunted around for a good setting for a novel. I didn't really know what the novel would be. And when I learned about Kamchatka, which is this incredibly beautiful volcanic peninsula in the Bering Strait, I thought, this is the place I want to go.
But let me ask you about the place, because, I mean, it's one thing to decide to write, to get interested in Russia, and I assume Russian literature and the language, but you didn't pick the Russia that most of us perhaps know of, or even whether it's through the literary tradition or through, of course, the geography. Kamchatka Peninsula, very remote. Why this place?
When I was looking for a place to go to write about at more length, I wanted to go someplace that was outside of Western Russia, because I had spent a little time in Western Russia and I wanted to see what else was in the biggest country in the world. I wanted to go someplace that was outside of a major metropolitan center. I was coming from New York, and I thought, I have some experience now living in cities and I'd like to live in a different place. And when I learned about Kamchatka, which is very remote, as you say, it's a 9-hour flight from Moscow. It's really the other side of the world. It's by Alaska, by Japan. And I saw how beautiful it was, and I learned more about its history and how foundational it was during the Cold War to the Soviet Union's conception of its own defenses and America's conception of the sort of threat that the Soviet Union posed. Mm-hmm. I really wanted to go. I looked at those pictures, I learned about that history, and I thought, this is the place that I've got my heart set on.
So a number of readers wondered about that. Let me just put a couple of these questions to you together, and you can respond. Svetlana Peterson of Hull, Massachusetts. As a Russian speaker, I often find much written taking place in the former USSR forced, at times not at all true to the spirit of that specific culture. How did you pay special attention to the cultural nuances of that part of the world? And then Dick Moxon of Medina, Washington. You seem to be very respectful of Kamchatka culture and society, but as an outsider, did you ever feel intrusive?
I always feel intrusive as an outsider, and especially as a writer. Then I moved to Kamchatka with the goal, and the goal was to learn as much as I could, absorb as much as I could, and then take those experiences and turn them into stories. You know, writing about Russia, the nuances of Russian culture, for me, it was really important to acknowledge to myself in the work that I will never be Russian. I'll never be from Kamchatka. I'll never have been born and raised in that place, even if I moved there and, you know, I spent about a year and a half there. If I'd spent 20 years there or 60 years there, I would still not be Kamchatkan or from there. And acknowledging that from the start for myself over and over again, acknowledging that everything I was seeing was filtered through my Americanness, through my foreignness, through my outsiderness, helped me work really hard to do the best that I could, knowing that the best that I could was different from what someone else's best might be if they are from inside.
That takes us a little bit to the structure of the book, because a lot of people wondered about that. In the first chapter, we meet two young girls, sisters. They're out, you know, again, this is a remote area, and a kidnapping occurs. The rest of the book, separate new characters introduced in every chapter, all women, sort of related, we're not quite sure related to the story, but a number of people, one reader just said, what was it that made you believe this was the best way to tell the overall story, that kind of structure?
The structure of Disappearing Earth is, I realize now more and more, very much a reflection of how, what kind of stories I'm interested in reading and how I think the world works, which is that I'm a big consumer of missing girl stories, stories of often girls and women in peril. And after a while of consuming those, you start to notice, okay, we have these tropes, we have these, you know, a victim, a perpetrator, a detective. It's a very, very tight triangle that supposes that that these crimes happen, for example, in isolation, or that other people don't influence or shape or take culpability in them, and that how they are solved, how they happen is because of one person's bad intention, and how they're solved is because of one person's brilliance. That is not my understanding of how violence happens in the world. I wanted to write a book that reflected that. I wanted to write a book about a community of people, all of whom have different influences on this kidnapping and on what happens afterwards.
And of course, a big part of that story, which again feels both familiar and different for many of us American readers, are the ethnic tensions involved in this particular place. There's an indigenous culture, there's a ethnic Russian, which is white in our terms, felt very familiar in many of the ways of things, the kind of attitudes, the kind of events that would take place, the way people would talk to each other, but a very different setting. This is something you had to learn, I assume.
Yes, yeah, something I had to certainly learn on Kamchatka about the particular ethnic and racial dynamics in place and the colonial and Sovietizing history of that particular place that are, especially Kamchatka, very, very particular to that region. I also had to learn through the writing a lot more about my own American understandings and cultural context of who is featured as someone deserving of investigation or care or time, and who doesn't. Somehow the writing of this novel on Kamchatka ended up teaching me more than I ever imagined about my home in the U.S.
Now, of course, to some degree, as we said, there's a mystery here. There's a whodunit. So, but Jeffrey Soule, I think it is, writing from Hawaii, says, how eager or wary were you to about resolving the story? Because that's not the way the story unfolds, as we've been saying. It's sort of around it, or a little bit at odds with it, or other people's stories.
This isn't my favorite thing to talk about with book clubs and with folks since the book has come out. I've had the really good luck of getting to talk about the ending with so many different people, and it's taught me a lot about writing. I didn't understand that when I wrote the ending, how open for interpretation the ending was. I'm a reader who loves a resolution, which might be funny to folks who have read the book, that. But my intention very much as a writer is to respond to my own appetites, which are, if I read a mystery or if I read a book that poses a question in the beginning, I want an answer by the end. It's hard for me to sit with open-endedness and not knowing what happened in a big way. So I wanted the ending of the book to tell people what happened in a way that was satisfying, but also novel or different from what we might expect. My hope is that the book gives that to people, but I've learned a lot from lots of conversations that people have very different reactions to what it means.
All right, I want to finish coming back to where we started with this particular moment of COVID-19, because there were some questions of people. How could they not be thinking of that right now as they're reading your book? So Susan Edgar Lee of Boynton Beach, Florida says, "In this time when so many people are in isolation with their partner or family, have you been thinking about how much your characters give voice to the challenge of loving someone close up?" And Kat Ennis of Richmond, Virginia, "What parallels have been going through your mind with COVID-19 pandemic and your book?" And I wonder myself, I mean, how much does this seep into you and think about perhaps how it changes you as a writer?
I have been thinking a lot about Kamchatka during this COVID-19 time, during this coronavirus era. Folks there are under a shelter-in-place order right now and staying at home. And I've been thinking about how connected every part of the world is, that there's no part of the globe that is untouched by the disease or by fear or by the desire to take care of each other by doing what we can and to help our communities. A lot of the characters in my book are in quite claustrophobic settings, dealing with the challenges of loving the people they're with up close because they're kept very, very close. But I've been thinking jealously of also how much open space they have around them. I'm talking to you from an apartment building that is quite densely packed around other apartment buildings, and I'm fantasizing about some of the open terrain of the Kamchatka Peninsula right now. That would be very nice to go out and be 6 feet away from other people. But I think this is a time that will change all of us, and I hope will change all of us for the better, especially when it comes to something that I want all of my work to convey, which is that we have to, authority is not necessarily going to save us. Authority is not going to look out for us or do its best for us always. And so we have to do our best for each other on a person-to-person level. We have to help each other. And I think about that now, what folks are doing in such generous and open-hearted ways to help each other. And that to me is something I never want to forget and I always want to keep talking about.
Well, Julia, that was great. And before we go, I want to let everybody know about our May pick. We're going to do something a little bit different. We're going to go back to an older book that is now being republished. It's called The Street by Ann Petrie. It was published in 1946. It's the story of a young woman's struggles in 1940s Harlem. It was a well-acclaimed, highly acclaimed when it came out, and it was the first novel by an African-American woman writer to sell more than a million copies. But for most of us, I think, it disappeared. It's being reissued with a new introduction by the contemporary novelist Tayari Jones, who I've talked to for our program. And Tayari is going to join me next month to, and all of us, to talk about what she discovered in this book and what she found, why it might have disappeared, why it's still relevant today. So, as always, I hope you will all stay with us for Now Read This, our book club partnership with the New York Times. And Julia Phillips, once again, disappearing Earth. Thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me.